Sarah Presley Howard, Madison Barlow, Madeline Maddox, Kaylee Harden, and Lillian Harvey. Coach Mary Claire Brock was also selected to coach in the All-Star Game. Would you give our 2021 state champion players and coaches a big round of applause? And now, coming to receive their rings, Kaylee Harden, Sarah Presley Howard, Addison Williams, Lola Ricketts, Holly Whitfield, Macy Lamb, Georgia Caroline Self, Elise Howard, Catherine Geesbury, Avery Howard, Elena Bono, Madison Barlow, Madeline Maddox, Larkin Camp, Yasmin Martinez, Lauren Hodo, Caitlin Lindley, Tammy Lynn Johnson, Ellie Beck, Lillian Harvey, Campbell Williams, Woody Marshall. The Lady Mustangs were led by head coach Mary Claire Brock and Mary Belk Harris. Give these ladies another round of applause.
So we're live a little early, as saw there, the 2021 state championship Lady Mustang soccer team was just honored as their rings came in. So congratulations to those ladies. Wanted to get the stream going so y'all can see that. We're still a little while from game time here, so we will just leave it on here, and we'll be back shortly with the starting lineups. Thank you.
Good evening and welcome to Lewis Coleman Field here at Utroska Park on the beautiful campus of Pillow Academy. I'm Barrett Donahoe, and I'll be joined today with Mr. John Banuzowicz.
Good evening.
How are you doing, John?
Doing just fine. How about yourself?
Did you call the JV game?
Did.
That's what I'm talking about. A man who is on a mission to get better at calling baseball games. I love it. We are happy to have John with us tonight, and we're excited about this conference matchup. The Starkville Volunteers come in, the highly touted Starkville Volunteers come into on campus today. I wouldn't say they're the favorites to win the division, but I think that Magnolia Heights and Starkville are the two clear contenders for not only our conference championship title, but also for the state title. As we've seen scores from both schools coming out this year, they're both very strong, and we're excited to see them play tonight.
Yeah, it's going to be a big test for our ball club, that's for sure. But baseball's a funny sport, you know. We got to throw in our ace tonight, Drew Lim.
The Mustangs come in at the record of 6-10 and have dropped seven in a row before starting 6-3 on the season. The Starkville do not have Starkville's record, but I know that they are a lot to very little and have done a tremendous job through the first part of the season. We're going to go ahead and give you starting lineups for both teams for tonight's game as the coaches are about to meet with the umpires at home plate and get ready for the introduction of starting lineups, and the national anthem will be played here before the game starts. But we'll go ahead and start with the Starkville Academy Volunteers. Harris McReynolds will be their leadoff batter. He will play shortstop, followed by Randall Futrell, the quarterback on the football team, who plays left field and will bat second. Aiden Alsobrooks will play right field and bat in the three hole. Colby Allen is the cleanup hitter, playing second base. Cooper McNeil will play center field and bat fifth. Evan Sirey will play third base and bat sixth behind Will McReynolds, who will play first base and bat seventh, followed by Hayes Davis catching, and Drew Williamson will round out the order in the nine hole as he will be the pitcher on the mound for the Starkville Academy Volunteers. The Pillow Academy Mustangs have a little bit of a shift in the lineup tonight, a little bit of a shakeup from top to bottom in the batting order. Nelson Hodges, who has been the steady leadoff man for the Mustangs, will lead off and play center field, followed by the pitcher Drew Lamb, who has moved his way up into the second spot in the order. He will be on the mound tonight for the Mustangs, as he was last Thursday night in the first game against Heritage Academy in the first conference game of the season that we played. J.C. Girard will bat third and play first base, followed by Dane Sanford, the cleanup batter who plays shortstop. Brock Magnuson will bat fifth and play third base tonight, followed by Chamberlain McLean, the freshman, who will designate be the DH. Trey Smits will bat seventh and play right field. Elliot Flowers is going to play second base and bat eighth. And to round up the lineup, Britt Reichley will be in the nine hole playing left field. Chamberlain McLean, the six hole hitter, will be DHing for the catcher Perry Smith, who came in the other night when Elliot Flowers got injured, was forced into the lineup in his first high school action of his career, and did a very good job behind home plate. So he gets the start tonight for Coach Thigpen.
Sure did. I'd say he earned it.
And he did get a hit in his five or six at-bats that he had the other night. He did walk away with a hit, but he's not going to be in the batting order. So a little bit of a shift in the lineup, Mr. B, as we Coach Thigpen and company are trying to find a way just to produce some runs.
That's right. Bats did wake up a bit on during the doubleheader against Heritage there. But, yeah, just trying to find the right combination of hitters that'll allow us to, you know, we're putting runners on pretty good. It's just a matter of, you know, stringing those hits together and start plating some of those runners. We're spreading an awful lot, and Judd just trying to shuffle things up to try to find that right combination that will allow us to score some runs with more consistency.
Well, as we look at the overview of the season and you kind of see the complete body of work, I think that the frustration for the team would be the performance over spring break. And if you take that performance out on that three-game stretch, they've really been very competitive in all games that they've played and, of course, the games they've won, but in conference play earlier this year. The Coast is a little bit of a, if I'd have to say, it's a little bit of an outlier to the total work of the season at this point.
Sure. You saw some games really spiral and snowball and have innings that ballooned to, you know, giving up six, seven runs, which really on the whole of the season, as you're saying, is the anomaly. Mustangs will get themselves into some trouble, don't get me wrong, but they have been pretty good at getting themselves out of trouble as well and kind of limiting damage, and that's the one thing we didn't really see at the Coast that has been kind of a mainstay the rest of the season.
I made an error earlier. We dropped six games in a row, not seven in a row, and that started on March the 16th against Terry High School in a game that we led 3-2 late in that game, and that game was one that you accurately defined as just kind of spiraling out of control. Last week against Heritage was a tough week for the Mustangs. We dropped three games in a series that was pushed back because of weather that came through on Tuesday of last week. The series was moved to Thursday, Friday, a three-game set, as all conference game sets are. We have five conference teams that we'll play, so that's a 15-game slate for our Mustangs. On Thursday night, we lost a tough game that Drew Lamb pitched exceptionally well in. We lost that game 6-2, and I know, Mr. B, that you were there, and you saw the firsthand action of what Drew did on the mound. Sure. What would you say was his strength that night?
He knew he was going to hit his spots. He had just an intensity about the way he went about it. When he got the ball back, he was already looking dead in to the catcher. Wanted to throw. Would get kind of a little frustrated if ever the somebody called time or the ump was holding things up, because he knew he was going to hit his spot, and he was really working the outside and the inside, really hitting the corners very well. They put some balls in play, but it's off of pitches that he went exactly where he wanted. So I think he was definitely about as on as we'd seen him since that Oak Forest game.
He pitched five complete innings in that matchup. He was the pitcher of record. He did receive the loss on the game. He gave up eight hits over five innings. He had two walks, six strikeouts. There were five runs scored while Lamb was on the mound. Four of those runs were earned. He had one earned run. And when you give that type of performance in a high school baseball game, you're giving yourself an opportunity to win. And to be honest, that's a game that we feel like we should win.
There's a lot of that. I think the dropping all three games to Heritage, I don't think that tells really the whole story of the Mustangs' performance as a whole over that series.
We came home on Friday night of last week to play Heritage in a varsity doubleheader. We turned around pretty quickly as the Mustangs arrived back in Greenwood at 10 o'clock the next morning, that night, and then had to turn around the next day and begin at 4 o'clock in the afternoon in a game that was probably one of the most exciting and unusual games that we've seen all year, and a lot of interesting stat lines that took place in that game. We dropped the first game of that doubleheader 11-10, and as Coach Thigpen described it this morning, it's one of those losses that he just hasn't quite got over yet.
No, the Mustangs came back from five runs down on two separate occasions in that game to either tie or take the lead, and were in a position to at least send it to extras, and just some unfortunate events there in the seventh.
Yeah, the Mustangs had runners on first and second with down one run, with Nelson Hodges, the speedy base runner, on second base, and a line drive from Brock Makinson was hit into right field. It was actually a hit and run situation. Nelson had taken off and was trying to get himself on the third base, and had a good steal opportunity, and the line drive was called right around the shoelaces by the fielder, and he was able to get it to second base, it doubles up and end the game. And just one of those situations that we would just really have loved to have seen something different, but it just didn't work our way.
Sure didn't. That one hurt.
Well, we're going to get ready for the announcement of the starting lineups and also the playing of the national anthem. We will come back when we get ready for play here momentarily.
Thank you. field, number 10, Nelson Hodges. Batting second and pitching, number 12, Drew Lamb. Batting third and playing first base, number 14, J.C. Gerard. Batting fourth and playing shortstop, number 8, Dane Sanford. Batting fifth and playing third base, number 7, Brock Mickelson. Batting six. Chamberlain. Number 9, Trey Schmitz. First. Elliot Flowers. Batting ninth and playing left field, number 15. And catching number 25, Perry Smith. Will you please stand for the prayer and remain standing for the national anthem? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day and for the opportunity to compete. Thank you, most of all, Lord, for your Son, Jesus. God, please protect these young men on the field and be with every single one of us tonight as we drive home. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
We apologize. Please be patient with us.
All right, so we're back and ready for action as junior Drew Lamb will toe the rubber.
Hope you all enjoyed that impromptu a cappella version of the national anthem.
You know, it's always always interesting to see how things will shape up. When you haven't had issues and all of a sudden you do, that's just part of it. So here will be Drew Lamb on the mound. Drew Lamb comes in as the number one ace starting pitcher for the Mustangs. Season stats for Lamb. You know, Mr. B, he's not going to look good in the stat line as far as wins and losses are concerned because he does usually pitch against some really good opponents, but he's had a tremendous season.
Sure
he's
has.
Thrown 26 innings, seven games that he's appeared in. He's 0-2 overall. He's not had a win on record to this point. He's given up 35 hits. 34 runs, 17 of those runs were earned. That's a very telling stat for different things that have taken place on our team this year, Mr. B, as he's given up only 17 of the 34 runs, only 17 of those are earned runs. He's struck out 34 batters, and he has not hit a batter yet. He has 13 walks on the season. He's got a 4.57 ERA, does the junior, and he's going to have to really be impressive and spot up tonight against this extremely potent and difficult Starkville Academy baseball team. And leading off will be the shortstop, Harris McReynolds. McReynolds, the speedy shortstop for the Volunteers. The last time we saw the Volunteers play.
Testing.
A game was in the playoffs last year, Mr. B. We played them in the second round of the playoffs as we got through Winston Academy in the first round and were able to move forward and play Starkville Academy. A game, a series that they took 2-0, but we really gave them problems here at home. The game got away from us late in the second game, and I remember distinctly a grand slam hit by J.C. Girard that got us back in that game.
I do remember that, Academy, yeah.
I believe in the fourth inning or so. But we were unable to come away with a victory. So the left-handed batter, McReynolds, will step up to the plate.
I think we're ready for some baseball.
And here comes Drew Lamb. First pitch is on the outside edge, and it is called a strike. So a good location and a good way to start for Lamb.
Absolutely. If he's going to get that call all night, then he loves to throw that inside pitch to righties, outside pitch to lefties, right over that left-hand side of the plate there.
And the breaking ball stayed up right there in the zone. And Lamb has had a little bit of a problem with that breaking ball early in the game staying up. So we'll see if he can't get this down against this left-handed batter. A high fly ball in the center field. That's hit right at Nelson Hodges. That ball is back, and that ball is gone. Dead straightaway center field, three pitches into the game, and a home run has been hit by the Volunteers. The flag was not blown. We do have a gusting wind out of the south tonight that's kind of blowing back across the field, but the wind really wasn't blowing heavy on that swing. But that fastball got inside on the hands of McReynolds, and he sent that one a long way.
We'll see how Lamb responds to that. If he comes back here and attacks, as he should, you got to have a short memory on the mound. Can't let that throw off your game plan.
Solo home run is not the worst thing in the world in baseball, but it definitely doesn't give you a lot of confidence early. But I agree with you. We'll see if he can't come back. You know, that left-handed pitch, that left-handed batter can be a difficult face for a right-handed pitcher. First pitch is out of the zone. Here's the 0-1 pitch. It's down for ball two, so 2-0 pitch. Now coming from Lamb. And that ball, if you could see it on from your view online, it really kind of ran back in on the hands, and he did a good job of getting out front of the pitch on the outside corner. Called strike. Once it out, 2-1 is the count. For Randall Futrell, the senior quarterback for the Volunteers. It's been fun watching him play. Ground ball hit towards Dane Sanford. That's going to get through. Hard hit ball just past the arms of Sanford, and that is going to be the second consecutive hit for the Volunteers.
Yeah, that ball was just smoked. Dane in good position, but not a lot he could do with that.
Aiden Alsobrooks will lead off. Will bat third, and he will come up to the plate with a runner on first base. Alsobrooks, a name that we called regularly last year in the playoff series. Starkville Academy wearing their all-orange uniforms.
It's bright.
It is a loud uniform. I agree. Fastball down in the zone, called strike one. Perry Smith kind of getting – going to see if they're going to test him early in the game. Kind of got out of his stance quickly right there. He's going to have to frame up, stay calm, relax. A little help from his pitchers here, checking it first. Runner takes off. Smith comes up and throws. The throw is not going to be in time, and Futrell is going to take the bag. A lot of speed by Futrell. Should be familiar with him. Should our players. So 1-1 count now to Alsobrooks, who has an opportunity to drive in a run here early in the first inning with a runner in scoring position. Ground ball hit just past the glove of J.C. Gerard as he moved to his left, and that's going to be a base hit. Futrell's going to come in to score. Throw over to second base, and that's going to be a tag and an out. Is also Brooks saw the right fielder for the Mustangs. Trey Schmidt bobbled the ball out in right field, but he came up. Schmidt had a really good throw to second base there to get the out.
Nailed him. Got greedy there. Ball was hit pretty hard, so it got to Trace there in a hurry. And good scoop and good awareness to see that he was going to second, and a great throw to nail him with plenty of time.
That was
one close.
Single in and out as he tried to advance to second. Fastball on the inside quarter called. Strike one against the four-hole hitting Colby Allen. So nobody on base, but two runs are in now for Starkville Academy. As the Volunteers have really shown what they're made of. Chopper towards third base is going to go foul back towards the dugout. And Lamb is way ahead in this count, 0-2. Lamb has done a good job of throwing strikes to this point.
He has. Find himself ahead 0-2 here.
So here's the 0-2 pitch to Allen. Swing and a miss and a strike three. Good pitch down and away from Allen, and a good job right there by Lamb coming back, staying confident, getting a couple outs. That'll bring up Cooper McNeil, the center fielder for the Volunteers. You know what I do like about the uniforms is they just own the colors. You know what I mean, Mr. Benoit? They own it.
Yeah, that's right. There's a lot of green and blue around. You don't see a lot of loud orange.
And this loud orange, and this, hey, look, I like it. Own it. Good breaking ball to start off McNeil on the outside edge for strike one. So Lamb, once again, working ahead in the count, not afraid to throw to these Starkville Academy batters after giving up three hits in a row. Fastball was up in the zone, and they actually called strike two. Little generous zone right now from
pretty,
the umpire.
Yeah, pretty, pretty wide there.
That would be a ball that would be difficult to hit for McNeil. And here's the 0-2 pitch. Swing and a miss, and back-to-back strikeouts from Lamb on a high-velocity fastball. And so great way to bounce back after the put out at second base when Austin Brooks was trying to advance. Two strikeouts in a row, but the Volunteers do strike first. Two runs on three hits. No errors by the Mustang. One man left. Nobody left on base.
Nobody left on, yeah.
We'll come back for the bottom half of the first inning shortly. So we are back here for the bottom half of the first inning, and the pitcher, Drew Williams, will take the mound for the Volunteers. Williams wears number 12, the right-handed pitcher. Good velocity, good control during warm-ups. See what that looks like for the Mustangs. Leading off will be Nelson Hodges. the senior center fielder for the Mustangs, batting .321 on the season. He has 64 plate appearances, 56 official at bats. He has 18 hits. 16 of those hits are singles. He has one double, no triples, but one home run. He has 12 RBIs on the season. He has scored 11 runs. So Hodges comes in. Comes in.
It's been swinging. Yeah, swinging a great bat lately.
Fastball on the outside edge, down around the knees, called strike one. Good location by Williams. Hodges has been consistent through the year, which is what you want from your leadoff batter.
Yeah, with all the shuffling we've done lately in the lineup, I think there's only been one game where he didn't lead off.
And another fastball on the outside edge is fouled way towards the big pit we have.
Yeah,
right
no,
in front of
no
the
longer a mountain of dirt. It is now a pit, as just even during the JV game, they were scooping that thing out.
So the 0-2 pitch now to Hodges with a big gap in right center field is a breaking ball that stays up in the zone, misses for ball one. Not afraid to attack Hodges right there. Hodges on base percentage for the year is .387. Gets on base, gives us a chance to score with the speed. Big gap in right center, as we just mentioned, as the center fielder is playing halfway between the .355 sign and the Lewis Coleman field sign, center field. The right fielder is playing very shallow. Aligned with the .345 sign. So here's the 0-2 pitch again and fouled off towards the dugout.
Good job to get a piece there and stay alive. Wasn't going to do much with that pitch, but forced the pitcher to waste it. Try it again.
So Hodges will see another. He will see a 1-2 pitch here. Here's the delivery from Williams and a ground ball towards the shortstop. He's going to glove it. He's going to come up. He's going to fire across to first base, and he is going to pick it out of the dirt.
Yeah.
Not a tremendous throw right there by the shortstop, Harris McReynolds, but the first baseman did a good job of picking it out of the dirt.
Good job of Hodges for hustling down the line, making that play close.
Absolutely. Drew Lamb, the starting pitcher, will step into the box, batting in the two-hole this year. I believe this is the first time batting second in the order. He will face the right-handed pitcher. First pitch is down in the zone, misses for ball one.
I believe JC led off the only game that Nelson didn't, but I think this is his first time at second.
Lamb's average is .300 on the season and 40 at bats, 56 plate appearances. He does lead the team in walks with 15 walks on the season. Ball misses way outside for ball two, so now Lamb ahead in the count, 2-0. He has a .500 on base percentage, which is a really good on base percentage for a high school baseball player.
Outstanding.
A lot of that attributed to the number of walks he's had. So here's the 2-0 pitch to Lamb. Fastball outside edge. Called strike one. So now 1-2 for Weeds. Going to be important for the Mustangs to have productive at bats and try to take the pitcher's deepened counts. Three-game series, you got to try to get starting pitchers off the mound. Here's the 1-2 pitch. 2-1 pitch is fouled off towards the Mustang dugout. And now two strikes on Lamb.
Good job by the Mustangs here. The first two batters have been seeing some pitches. Really getting to know, really showing them and the whole team really what all, everything the pitcher's got. More pitches to force them to throw early.
So here comes the 2-2 pitch to Lamb. And it's a ground ball hit softly towards the second baseman. He's going to glove it and throw it over to first, and that's going to be the second out of the inning. Lamb kind of hit that off the end of his bat.
Now batting number 14.
Second baseman Colby Allen did a good job of coming up and making the play. That'll bring up J.C. Girard, the team leader in batting average, three-hole hitter who batting .500 on the season with a .661 on-base percentage. Scored 19 runs. He has 21 hits on the year. 13 of those are singles, 8 doubles. No home runs and no triples for the left-handed batter. First pitch is on the outside edge, misses for ball one.
Yeah, with the Mustangs showing a lot more power than they did last year, it still surprises me to hear that JC does not have a home run this season. He's got some pop. We were just talking about his grand slam against this team last year.
Ball inside, misses for ball two. So now 2-0 the count to Girard. His grand slam last year against Starkville Academy got the Mustangs back in game two for a brief amount of time. He hit that opposite field, actually. It went over the left center wall in Starkville. Foul ball towards it. Mustang dugout there will be the first strike in the event. Wind picking up a little bit. Once again, blowing right to left.
As you can tell on your screen, with the screen kind of being sailed a bit over first base there.
1-2 pitch to Girard. It's a line drive that's going to get down for a base hit. So Girard picks up the first hit of the afternoon for the Mustangs. He turned on that breaking ball and ripped it right over the second baseman's head for a nice single and a two-out single for Dane Sanford.
Yeah, ripped it there.
Who will step up to the plate as the 4-0 hitter. Power threat for the Mustangs. Sanford's batting 462 on the season. Has 5 home runs on the season so far through 16 games. And there's a ground ball hit towards second baseman. And it goes right underneath his glove for a base hit. I will believe they'll call that a hit for Sanford. And since we're standing right next to the official scores in the press box, we'll just go ahead and call it a hit.
That's right.
As he got just under the glove of Colby Allen as he was ranging right to left towards first base. And so now Brock Mason comes up with it in a big spot with runners on first and second here and nobody out. So Brock Makemson, the third baseman today, Brock, the utility player for the Mustangs, plays in a lot of positions. We'll see him pitch at some point during this three-game series over the next 3 days. Here comes the pitch to Makemson. It's a high fly ball into right center field. Going back onto his right fielder, and he's able to get underneath it and make the play, and the balls are able to get out of the inning. But the Mustangs do show some promise on offense as they're able to scrape out two hits, but they aren't able to get any runs. No runs on two hits. No errors by the Volunteers. Two men left on base. We will head to the top of the second momentarily. Evan Seary will step up to the plate, the third baseman for the Volunteers, to face Drew Lamb here in the top of the second inning with the Volunteers leading 2-0 after getting 2 runs on 3 hits in the first inning. Here's the first pitch by the right-handed pitching Lamb. It's a fastball that's hit sharply towards Dane Sanford, and he's able to glove it, a line drive, and get the first out of the inning. One pitch, one out. We'll take that all day long, Mr.
All
B.
All day. He's about to get in about how Drew's been pretty good when he's working deep into counts and getting ahead to hitters. But, first pitch out. That saves the trouble.
Throw strikes, see what happens. Here comes up Will McReynolds, the first baseman, who made a good play on the out for Nelson Hodges, the pick in the dirt. Breaking ball in there for strike one. Good pitch right there by Lamb.
Yep, so picking up right where he left off that last game in Heritage, where he had all his pitches working, he knew it, could throw them anywhere he wanted for strikes, or close to strikes, if he just so chose.
Ball down in the dirt, misses for ball one. Looked like a changeup. You know, Lamb is offset to, kind of offsets with his left foot in front of his right foot on the mound when he's in the wind up, comfortable stance for him. There were some interesting conversations about that and how that is changing in college baseball and Major League Baseball, where they're not allowing pitchers to do that anymore. So we'll see if that ever trickles down into the high school level. Here comes the 1-1 pitch. Fastball in there on the inside corner for strike two. So 1-2 count now to McReynolds.
Drew's doing a great job of painting both corners here in the second inning.
So here's the 1-2 pitch. Breaking ball misses up in the zone again. And as we said, he kind of patted his chest right there, Lamb did, and said, my bad. He just didn't quite get over the top of that enough to get that hook you wanted. That'll be ball two, 2-2 count. And a swing and a miss and the third strikeout of the game for Lamb against McReynolds as Perry Smith's able to hold on to the foul tip ball. It was a little up in the zone. And another strikeout for Lamb. And two up, two down so far for the Mustangs.
I tell you what, this is not a little league lineup that he is striking out. This is some impressive stuff.
Hayes Davis, the catcher, will step up to the plate. And you can see that by the swings and the patience at bat for the balls. They just look very poised in the box. They don't look intimidated by any pitchers. They look, they just look like a solid offensive ball club. First pitch misses up in the zone for ball one.
And a quick look through their box scores today, kind of confirmed that they are a pretty offensively potent ball club. So excellent job by Drew here so far.
Pitch on the outside corner, call strike one. So now 1-1 count. I can't confirm this. I'll try to look it up in between innings. I did look at their box scores at one point. I want to say they've won close to 20 games already this season. Here's the 1-1 pitch, and it's in on the hands, and I don't think it hit the batter. The batter kind of kind of waved his hand right there, but it looks like he got the umpire's arm. He ran in on the hands of the batter.
Good classy move here. Judd telling Perry to go talk to Drew, give the umpire some time to collect himself a bit. The other umpire will come over and clean the plate. Just give him a few.
Nice baseball etiquette right there by Smith. Big pin, the umpires, Lamb. The freshman Smith learning a little baseball etiquette here.
Really good to see. In the JV game, they had a catcher got a piece, and the ump went and dusted a perfectly clean plate just to give him a second.
Nice to see that we have people that understand the game of baseball. So 2-1 count now as the umpire looks like he's set to get ready back for action to catcher Hayes Davis. Nine-hole hitter Drew Williams, the pitcher, stands in the on-deck circle. Sure would like to finish this off with a clean inning. Here's the 2-1 pitch to Davis, and it's another breaking ball that is called right in there on the upper part of the zone.
He's dramatic with these calls.
He
makes you wait a second, but
no doubt about
been
it.
Been in our favor here so far. So
here's the 2-2
pitch. Not complaining.
Ball that misses up in the zone right there.
Good spot to miss.
Absolutely. So this will be the first full count at bat for either team tonight here in the second inning. Here's the full count pitch. And a ground ball towards third baseman Brock Makeson, and it goes right between his legs. That's going to be an error on Makeson as the Mustangs had the opportunity there to get out of the inning and just can't quite finish that off. And with the top of the order coming up shortly, momentarily, you really would like to see the Mustangs get out of this.
Yeah, Drew's just got to shake that off. No damage done yet. Just focus on getting this hitter here and get out of the inning unscathed.
So Williams will step up to the plate. It's the catcher, Hayes Davis, stands on first. I did not see Mr. B if they put a courtesy runner in for the catcher.
I didn't see one go in.
But I would anticipate with two outs that they would try to move against Lamb and Smith here. Lamb does have a quick delivery, and that's a first pitch strike for Fastball strike for strike one. Lamb does have a quick delivery to home plate. Smith is a freshman, still learning, Smith is a sophomore, and the sophomore is getting his first playing time. Pop time down to second base. He showed a pretty decent arm the other night against Heritage Academy. I believe he threw somebody out at second base.
Got a hit in his first at-bat, threw a man out, and that's I think maybe why I can see him in here today. Having the luxury of three people he can throw in at catcher is in fact that luxury.
Runner takes off, and there's a high fly ball that's fouled off down the third base line. That's going to get out of play as a hit and run was on the 1-1 count here with two outs for the Volunteers. So here comes the 1-2 pitch. It's fouled off again out of play as Trey Smith will give it chase, but the ball's going to get out of play.
Yeah, good pitch there by Drew. That was a very late swing on a ball. Some late movement. So pretty good job by the batter to even catch up with that.
You know, when we play the Volunteers, I'm always interested to see my good friend Jeremy Nicholas, Mr. B. I don't think you know Jeremy. He's the head of school at Starkville Academy. Really, really good guy. He wasn't able to make the trip tonight. We're missing having him here on our campus. Here is the 1-2 pitch, and Lamb's going to check over. You know, people say that we look alike. That's what people tell us when we go to different places, that me and Mr. Nicholas look alike.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I'm slightly better looking than he is. And he's a little bit dumber than I am, so it makes sense. But he is a really good guy. Hope to see him on Thursday night.
Well, we will finish up this three-game series with a doubleheader at Starkville, and we'll be there.
And last time he put us broadcasting from the back of the press box on the football field. Now that I've said that he's dumber than I am, I would imagine that we'd probably broadcast from somewhere out on the road. Called strike three right there on the 1-2 pitch from Lamb, and Lamb is able to work his way out of the inning after the error at third base. So good outing once again, good inning by Lamb right there to face the bottom half of the Starkville Academy order.
Outstanding to get that last out before that lineup turns over.
No runs, no hits, one error by the Mustangs. One man left on base for Starkville Academy. We'll head to the bottom of the second inning. Starkville Academy 2, Pillow Academy 0. So Chamberlain McLean, the DH for the Mustangs, will lead off the bottom of the second in a game that the Mustangs are trailing 2-0. McLean is batting .265 on the season. He has 40 at-bats, 35 official plate appearances. He has 9 hits. 8 of those hits are singles, 1 double.
Definitely shows a lot of power.
You know, he's right now, I would say, as a freshman, he's kind of a Deadpool hitter.
Yep.
Likes to hit everything as a left-hand hitter, likes to pull everything to the right side of the infield. But definitely shows power.
Yeah.
It would not shock me, and I'm not going to call it right now, Mr. B, but it would not shock me to see McLean go hit a home run in a varsity game before the end of the season. When he makes contact, he makes hard contact, has real good exit velo, and exit velo is all the rage in baseball right now.
Velo short for velocity.
That coming from one of the members of our science department. We appreciate him understanding what velocity people are. Can you give us a definition of velocity?
Yeah, it's speed with a direction attached.
Speed with a direction attached. See, Ms. Branch, it's that easy. So here's the first pitch to McLean, and it's fouled away, fastball on the outer edge, fouled over the press box.
Chamberlain had one at bat at Kirk where he fouled off two pitches that would have been about 400-foot shots that just missed down the line. So dead pull, like you're saying, but
swing and a miss on a off-speed pitch down in the zone for strike two. So now 0-2 count quickly to McLean.
I'm going to join you in your projection there that I would not be surprised either to see him homeward before the year's out.
When he does it, I'm hoping I'm there with you to see it so we can tell him that we caught it. Long look in by Williams. The 0-2 pitch is down in the zone for ball one. So now 1-2 count for McLean. McLean's played mostly in right field. He's DH'ing tonight. It's Trey Smith is in right field, and Perry Smith is catching. Smith's really showed a good look out there in right field.
Yep.
With the arm. You know, right fielders have to have a good arm to get the ball to third base. Smith could be a natural right fielder before the season's over. And high fly ball hit down the left field line, foul territory. Third baseman giving chase. He's going to try to make the play, and he cannot.
He cannot. Fell out of his glove. He had room. The ball stayed in play.
Don't think the catcher was able to get to the fence quick enough to give him a call for room, and he continued to kind of glance down and look.
See if McLean can turn that gift into getting on base. As he's found second life in this at-bat after the drop by Starkville in foul territory.
So here's the 0-2 pitch. 1-2 pitch. I apologize. It's down in the zone for two. Ball number two. So now 2-2 count to McLean. Left-handed batter. 2-2 count here in the second inning. Fastball, ground ball in the four-hole. That's going to be a base hit for McLean and the third base hit of the afternoon for the Mustangs.
Good piece of hitting, finding the hole there.
Now batting number nine, Trey Schmitz.
Hit it hard enough so that neither the first baseman or second baseman had time to get anywhere close to it.
You saw the catcher kind of look at his coach and give a motion as if McLean kind of just reached out and poked it. He was trying to locate on the outside corner to stay away from the pull hitter. I really think the ball ran back inside on him a little bit. McLean had a pretty good swing on that. But you can see where they're trying to locate McLean from what the catcher was motioning. Trey Smith steps up the right field. I would not be surprised to see him possibly square the bunt, and he does. And he tries to lay the bunt down, drops the bat head, and fouls it off. Smith's the right fielder. His bat has been in the lineup off and on. But he does have 46 plate appearances. He's got 11 hits, 9 singles, 1 double, and 1 home run. Not much of a lead over there for McLean. Smits squares around again, fouls it off to the catcher. The catcher's going to make the play, and Smits can't get the bunt down, and that will be the first out of the inning.
That bunt went sky high. Elliot Flowers.
That'll bring up Elliot Flowers, the second baseman tonight for the Mustangs. Glad to see him healthy as he exited the game on Friday night against the first game on Friday night against Heritage Academy with an injury to his hip. Ball down in the zone, misses for ball one to Flowers. Had ice on his hip for the remainder of the evening, but he was able to get through the weekend and come back and practice yesterday. Looks good tonight and has looked good so far on second base. Here's the 1-0 pitch from Williams. Another towards the pitcher. Williams is going to have to hustle. He hits the ground as he tries to stop and throw over to first base, and that's going to be an infield hit for Flowers, who has good speed, who is able to run it out.
Yeah, I even field it cleanly. I don't know if the pitcher can turn and fire it that late.
Well, he had to get down and field it and when he tried to make a turn, he kind of slipped and went to the ground. Not sure if he'd have been able to get the runner as the ball was really as good as a bunt.
Good situation here for the Mustangs with two on and only one down with top of the lineup coming on after Britt Reichley here. Britt Reichley, who's really adept at getting on base.
Britt Reichley squares the bunt. He pulls back on the ball up in the zone, and it's called a ball by the umpire. It looked like it might have been a pretty decent pitch. Catcher jumped up quickly out of his stance. Davis. Reichley squares again and pulls back for ball two. So now 2-0 to Reichley. We'll see if they leave the bunt on here with two balls and no strikes, two men on base, and Nelson Hodges on deck here for the Mustangs. So Reichley will square around. Reichley will step in the box. I apologize. Here's the 2-0 pitch. He squares around. Ball down in the zone, misses, and now Reichley has a 3-0 count. So four hits on the evening so far for the Mustangs. But we got to do something with it here, Mr. B. You got to take advantage of having base runners, multiple base runners for the second inning in a row.
Yep, left two on, stranded two in the first. Got two on now with another out to work with. Only one out in the inning. So
Reichley squares around the bunt. He's taking all the way, and that's going to be ball four. And Reichley draws a four-pitch walk, and the bases are full for Nelson Hodges, the leadoff batter for the Mustangs. And you're going to see a visit from Starkville Academy to the mound. And while they take that visit, we're going to take a break. So we'll be back momentarily. The Mustangs threatening here in the bottom of the second. Good things happen when Wine Melon,
Nelson Hodges.
No rain comes on the loudspeakers, and that's what just happened from the Diamond Girls here in the press box. So we'll see what Hodges can do here with the bases loaded and one out in the bottom of the second inning. Hodges and Drew Lamb up to bat in the order next. Hodges swings and misses at a fastball down in the zone for strike one.
Big opportunity here.
Hodges 0 for 1 on the afternoon. Grounded out to the shortstop in his first plate appearance. Swing and a miss on another fastball on the outside edge for strike two. So now 0-2 is the count to Hodges.
It's two swings and misses here. You'd love to be able to put the ball in play. Even if it's an out, you can at least plate somebody with the bases full.
Here's the 0-2 pitch. Ground ball fouled away towards the first, towards the third base dugout. Hodges kind of got over the top of that breaking ball. As Williams has shown a tendency to get ahead in the count with fastballs and come back with that breaking ball on 0-2. We'll see if he does it again here. Here's the big pitch by Williams. Fastball, ground ball towards third baseman. And it goes right under his glove. One run's going to score. Two runs are going to score. And the ball game is tied on the ground ball towards third base by Nelson Hodges.
Now batting number two.
Great piece of hitting right down the line. Elliot Flowers on his horse the whole way. Judd, no hesitation, and once that ball got past him and sending him, and able to good aggressive base running there, ties the game.
Ground ball could have been a double play ball if he gloves it cleanly. He could have stepped on third and gone to first. Of course, Nelson has really good speed. It'd have been a tough play. Probably would have played it a run. But a big break right there for the Mustangs. And Drew Lamb squares the bunt. He lays one down the first baseline. First baseman's going to come up. He's going to fire over to first and make the out on Lamb, who moves the runners up. But not a bad thought by Lamb right with J.C. Gerard coming up to the plate, having two runners in scoring position.
And, he was trying to give himself up and move the runners up. But you know what? That was a darn good bunt, and Starkville needed to have everyone rotate correctly and field it cleanly to make that play, which they were able to do. But I tell you what, he made it interesting. It was a great bump by Drew there.
Well, you need a big two-out base hit right here by Gerard to play a couple more runs and take a lead here in the second against Starkville Academy, one of the top teams in the state of Mississippi in baseball this year. Here's the first pitch draw. It's down in the zone, misses for ball one.
Good job by the catcher there to stay in front of that. Pass ball can play to run here, break this tie.
So here's the 1-0 pitch to Gerard. High fly ball into left field. That ball's hit deep, but I believe the left fielder's going to get under it. He does, and the Mustangs will strand two. But not a bad inning right there for the Mustangs as they were able to play two and tie this ball game back up. There were two runs scored on two hits, one error by the Volunteers. We'll head to the top of the third inning. 2-2 is your score. So we are back here for the top of the third inning and the top of the order, the dangerous top of the order for the Starkville Volunteers as they will face Lamb for the second time. Harris McReynolds led off the game with a home run on the third pitch that he saw from Lamb. Dead center field, went just left of the Lewis Coleman sign on a hard hit ball that just kept traveling. Lamb throws him a ball down the zone for ball one. What Lamb's been really impressive with so far has been his control. Fly ball out of play, hit to the left side of the infield for strike one. So 1-1 now is the count. So here comes the 1-1 pitch to McReynolds. Breaking ball that misses up in the zone for ball two. So now 2-1 is the count. One pitch. Misses again up in the zone on the breaking ball for ball three. So 3-1 count. So now a 3-1 count and a hitter's count for a good leadoff batter here for Starkville Academy. Swing and a line drive down the left field line. It's going to go foul. Just couldn't quite get it to ball on the outside corner of the plate to stay on the plate to stay fair. Here comes the full count pitch. So here's the full count pitch from Lamb, and it's a line drive into left field, and that's going to get down. Once again, he got in on the hands of McReynolds, and McReynolds made him pay with his second hit. He now has a home run and a single.
You know what? I'll take the single over the home run. It's an improvement there.
Randall Futrell will step up to the plate. Absolutely. Don't want to give up any runs in that position. Of course, we know every time the top of their order comes up that they have a threat to put up a number of runs, so Very important inning here for Lamb as the Mustangs were able to scratch out two runs and tie the ball game back up in the second. Lamb's first pitch is a fastball in there for strike one. Futrell didn't like it.
I get it. He's been calling the kind of the high and wide strikes. It's been kind of a wide zone. I'd say that pitch was kind of high, but he's been calling that a strike. So this is the second time up at bat. He should know.
Tailed inside on him a little bit too. Lamb checks his runner over at first base. Forces the runner back to the bag. Lamb's pitch count right now shows 37 on the scoreboard. Not bad through two full innings and a batter. Here's the 0-1 pitch. It's a fastball down the zone that misses four ball one, so now 1-1. So here's the 1-1 count as Lamb checks the runner, and the ball gets away from Gerard, and McReynolds is going to be able to take second base. Didn't have a good angle to see it from my vantage point here, but it looked like the ball was down around the bag.
I can't see the whole right side of the infield as this window is.
Mr. Renuzowicz has been asking for a new window for 2 years. We've told him that supply chain shortages have caused issues with window purchases throughout the country, which is why he doesn't have one. What Mr. Renuzowicz doesn't understand is he can open the window and see just fine. And the 1-1 pitch gets away from Smith. First wild pitch of the night by Lamb. Ball hit in the left-hander's batter box and got away from Smith.
See, if I close the window, then I can't see the left side of the field.
Problems persist for Mr. Renuzowicz this evening. Here's the 2-1 pitch. It's a high fly ball on the infield. Elliot Flowers is going to try to call everybody off. He tries to settle under, and he makes the play and forces the runner back to third base, and a big out right there by Lamb and a big first out of the inning.
Now batting number 3, Aiden Alsobrook.
And I'll tell you, not a bad job by freshman Elliot Flowers. That ball was hit sky high.
Yep. Good of him to take command and get everyone out of the way early and sit underneath it. Well, it's very windy today. So, kind of a tricky, but he settled underneath that fine and made a good play.
Aiden Alsobrooks, who got to hit his first at bat, singled into right field. The ball was bobbled by Trey Smith on the ground. Alsobrooks saw the bobble as he turned at first, tried to make it in the second, didn't realize Smith's, I guess he underestimated Smith's arm, and Smith threw him out by a good 5 or 6 feet, made the first out of the game for the Mustangs. Another ball inside misses. 2-0 count now to Alsobrooks. So the Volunteers went home run, single, single. After that, they're able to, Mustangs are able to crowd, and there's a hard hit line drive that gets down in front of Hodges, and that'll play to run, and that'll be Alsobrooks' second hit of the game, his second single of the game. And the fifth hit off of Lamb through 2 1/3. All of those hits coming from the top three batters in the Volunteer order. So that'll give the Volunteers the lead again. They regain it 3-2 here at the top of the third. And Colby Allen, the second baseman, will step up to the plate. He struck out his first plate appearance. Alsobrooks not with much of a lead over at first. Ball gets away from Smith. He can't pick it right there out of the dirt, and Alsobrooks is going to move up. You know, Mr. B, I kind of got a new philosophy on base running in the MAIS in high school baseball.
Yeah, what's up?
Anybody who puts on the mitt when they're going to run bases is a threat to steal a base. Would you agree or disagree with that?
I would agree. It's certainly not for fashion. Those things look ridiculous.
I think the base runners don't think they look ridiculous. It's kind of like the early 90s or late 90s, early 2000s in capri pants. Ladies didn't think they looked ridiculous. Foul ball right there on the 1-0 pitch.
Yeah, we'll be back next inning with the results of our Diamond Girl poll on Capri Pants.
Colby Allen. Now 1-1 count with a runner in score position. Sanford doing a good job of working the base runner. So he moves his way back to shortstop. Good breaking ball right there by Lamb. And Allen now down 1-2 in the count.
Those mitts you're describing, it's kind of hard to see on the screen, but a big old oven mitt that's meant to protect your fingers when sliding head first, a la stealing bases.
Never slid head first. Now, Mr. B, we'll talk a little bit about your collegiate playing career here shortly.
Uh-huh.
And here's the 1-2 pitch, and it's a soft hit fly ball into right field. Trey Smith is going to trail over. He's going to make the play, throw it into Sanford. The runner, also Brooks, is going to tag from second to third to advance with no contest from Sanford. But another big out for Lamb.
Trace is first time working right field so far this inning. He's got two opportunities and two great plays.
Cooper McNeil step up. He struck out to end the first inning. And this is a big batter, the left-handed batter for the Volunteers. It's a big batter right here for not only for Lamb, but also for Smith, because with a runner 90 feet away in high school baseball, we know anything can happen. Ball inside misses for ball one on the fastball. Good velocity right there by Lamb. His velocity seems to be increasing as the innings tick on. Trying to work his way out of base runner score position, and the ball right there goes off of Smith's knee, and the runner will score. Don't know exactly what happened. I feel like that was a decent pitch. I don't think it got in the dirt, did it?
No, it might have gone under the glove maybe. Might have had his glove too high. But, yeah, that definitely hit off that knee pad somewhere, because that ball bounced all the way to the Starkville dugout there.
So the 2-1 pitch, or 2-0 pitch, is fouled off, and that will be the first strike on McNeil. Now Lamb will try to find his way back into this count. So two runs plated here in the top of the third by Starkville Academy. Breaking ball outside corner. Call strike two. So now 2-2 the count. Tim McNeil. And here's the 2-2 pitch. Swing and a foul ball towards the first base dugout. If it wasn't a 2-2 count before, Mr. B, if you heard Mr. B over the live stream correcting me on the count, he was correcting the Diamond Girls, actually. 2-2 count again. Here comes the pitch. Swing and a ground ball towards Flowers. Flowers gloves it. He throws over Jordan. That will be the way that the inning ends. So the Volunteers do pick up two more runs, two runs on two hits. No errors for the Mustangs. Nobody left on base. We'll head to the bottom of the third. 4-2, Starkville Academy leads. So four-hole hitting Dane Sanford will step up to the plate. Sanford singled in his first at bat. 4, 5, 6 up. Sanford Makeupson and McLean will be up to bat. The Mustangs have scratched out four hits so far against the starting pitcher, Drew Williams. Here's the first pitch to Sanford, and it's fouled off right over my head here in the press box. I am not quite as afraid of foul balls as Mr. B is.
I'll tell you what, all that came from that man right there at the plate as Dane Sanford hit about three right off this window, that the messed up window that I was complaining about. That thing saved my life about three times with Dane at the plate.
Ground ball up the middle. Pitcher tried to glove it. Second baseman does, picks it up, and throws Sanford out for the first out of the inning. That'll bring up Brock Makeupson. Makeupson flew out to left field to end the first inning.
Number seven, Brock Makeupson.
Flew out to right field to end the first inning. I apologize. And the ball hit in the gap. It just stayed up, sailed a little bit with the wind blowing, kind of kicked it up.
Speaking of wind blowing, the wind direction has kind of sailed.
Makeupson gets under another one. This one looks like it's going to stay in fair territory, close to the on deck circle, and the ball drops in between the third baseman and the catcher. No play is made. It is so much harder than it seems.
Mm-hmm. And with the wind there playing tricks on the ball, you see, again, apologize for first base being covered on your screen there. The wind has kind of picked up and has made a sail out of the net a bit. Not a lot I can do about that, but luckily you can kind of see it through a hole, but I know it's distracting, but we're stuck with it.
If you can't see it, listen to the broadcast, and we'll try to get you what you need. Information-wise, there's the 1-0 pitch. He's up in the zone and inside. Makeupson is a 1-1 now to count. There were five people polled in the fan poll tonight on whether or not you like the style 1997 to 2004 Capri pants. Here's the 1-1 pitch, and it's a line drive up the middle. Base hit from Makeupson. Gets by the second baseman. Good piece of contact by Makeupson, and the fifth hit for the Mustangs. Of the results, 0% of people polled at tonight's poll like the 1997 to 2004 style capri pants, unless being worn by baseball players.
Yeah, that's the interesting bit. They're in favor of baseball players wearing capri pants, which I don't really know what that even means. But
I think it means pulled up to your knees with the long stockings as the pitcher for the Volunteers have.
That's okay.
Swing and a miss right there by Chamberlain McLean as he comes up to the plate. He singled in his first at bat in the second inning. Actually, singled and scored a run. He was the beginning of the two-run second inning that tied the ball game. Love to see him turn on one here. Well, as we said, we have a prediction for him before the end of the season, the freshman left-handed batter. As the wind picks up, ball is up in the zone, misses, and froze Makeupson. Don't think he saw the catcher miss.
Tough to see because the catcher did come up with it, and the ball popped out after the fact. So I think by the time Brock realized what was going on, as it took the catcher by surprise too, so he didn't react when it fell out.
That's a hard read right there by Makeupson.
Yeah, very, very tough read.
Especially with the left-handed batter as well.
Yeah.
So here's the 1-1 count. That ball is a breaking ball that misses badly outside.
It almost looked like a pitch out, but Brock was not moving on that pitch. 2-1 count, regardless, as the second baseman will come give some encouragement to his pitcher there.
Miss Hargett is asking for a picture of the new logo behind home plate. We're a little disappointed, Mr. Bedouz, which we don't get disappointed in many things that you do.
Okay, do you want to see the game?
Do you want to see
that foul territory?
High fly ball by McLean. Looks like it might stay in fair territory. It will. Third baseman settles under it, and he makes the play in foul territory for the second out of the inning. Mr. Benu, you didn't really give me an opportunity to tell you what we were disappointed in before you got a little defensive about the new logo that's painted behind home plate.
I'll let you finish.
I lost my train of thought between the foul ball out and the aggressive tone in which you talked to me. Now Trey Schmidt will step up to the plate. Schmidt flew out to the catcher on a bunt attempt. A little flare towards the first baseman. First baseman's going to settle underneath it. He'll make the third out of the inning, and that's the way the Mustangs go down. No runs on one hit. No errors by the Volunteers. One man left on base. We'll be back to finish the conversation between me and Mr. Benu at the beginning of the fourth inning here shortly.
Into the Bowie bit.
Head into the top of the fourth inning.
Now batting number seven, Evan Seary.
Evan Seary will step up to the plate, the third baseman, to face Drew Lamb in his third inning of work. Lamb has given up four runs on five hits tonight. All five of those hits coming from the first three batters in the order for the Volunteers. Here comes Seary, who flew out to Dane Sanford to start the second inning, who sees a breaking ball. First pitch in there for strike one. Coach Thigpen had some interesting conversation with Coach Thigpen today about pitching strategy as we move through this series and as he moves through. And there's a check swing. There's an appeal and a called strike right there on a ball way out of the zone. If Seary was fooled on that off-speed pitch, it looked like it might have been on this changeup. So here's the 0-2 pitch now. We'll see what Lamb does. Throws it up and in. Kind of got away from him there.
Yeah.
And the conversation, Mr. B, was about how to use pitchers in these three-game series and what you do with Lamb, pitching him at home versus pitching him away, pitching him against better pitchers, knowing that taking games is going to be the ultimate thing that happens to get you in the playoffs, especially against a good team like Starkville. So here's the 1-2 pitch from Lamb. A ground ball foul. Seary to stay in the count. The conversation was, depending on how this first part of this game went, would depend on how many pitches Lamb threw and see about his availability for Thursday. But I believe at this point Lamb's going to out-pitch his availability for Thursday because he's pitched really well.
Oh, he sure has. Very, very high-powered offense that Lamb's doing an excellent job of keeping in check here.
Ground ball towards Makepson. He gloves it cleanly. He's going to throw across the first. The ball sails really high. And it goes to the wall, and that is a killer for the Mustangs there as we had an easy ground ball out to start the inning, and we throw it away.
Now batting number 15, Will McReynolds.
But Lamb continuing to pitch strong.
Yep, he's said he's got the strikeouts working and inducing a lot of ground balls. Got to do a better job of turning those into outs.
Well, as we say, you know, Makepson is a utility player for us. He plays a lot of different positions, and that, you know, is because of his skill set. And struggled right there. Ball bunted towards the third baseman, and no rotation
safe,
from Makepson. And Lamb's looking over at him, talking to him. A really good bunt right there by McReynolds is going to be an infield single. And that will advance the runner to third base. And now the Mustangs in a little bit of trouble here with nobody out and runners on first and third in the top of the fourth inning. So Perry Smith will come out and call the first and third defense. Davis reached on an E5, his last plate appearance. Infield playing back at the moment in the middle, playing for the double play. Pitch misses up for ball one as the Starkville dugout gets into it for the first time in this game. Six hits now in the evening for Starkville Academy. So here's the 1-0 pitch. Ball down in the zone, swing and a miss by Davis. You're in danger of having to face the top of the order again in this inning. Really would like to have avoided them. But a double play is the only way to avoid that at this point.
Well, last time we talked about double plays being very timely, we were rewarded.
Runner moves, and Smith is not going to attempt a throwdown, so the double play will not be in order, but a great breaking ball in there for strike number two, and Lamb now has two strikes on the batter. And looking for his fifth strikeout of the evening. So here's the 1-2 pitch. Breaking ball, actually changeup stays up in the zone. Runner at second base getting a big lead over there. Love to see the middle infield work that runner a little bit. Lamb now throws with a 2-2 count. And a fly ball out of play back towards the field house. We'll hit the top of the field house.
Does he win something for that?
Absolutely not.
Just the Scott?
Just if you hit the Scott multi-purpose building. It can't be a one-hop, Mr. B. It's got to be.
On the fly.
On the fly, off any part of the building itself.
It's a good 420 feet or so.
High fly ball into right field. It's going to actually land in front of Smith. It looked like a playable ball by Smith. And he let it land in front of him. He must have been playing fairly deep because off the bat, it looked like he had a play
now
on it.
Batting number 13, Drew
and
Lowe.
Judd Thigpen, the head coach for the Mustangs, is going to come out and talk to Lamb.
Now, Drew's a confident kid, but you got to look at what's been happening this inning. He's saying, like, you know, what's going on here? You know, he's getting the kind of contact that he's looking for, and yet he really doesn't have any outs to show for it.
An error to start the inning, and then a bunt single by the Volunteers. And now another single hit in front of Trey Smits. Has another first and third situation for the Mustangs as Thigpen's out there talking to his pitcher, trying to get him to get up, get ready to go. But the Starkville Academy Volunteers add to their lead. They now lead 5-2 here in the top
now
of the fourth inning.
13, Drew Williams.
And Drew Williams, the pitcher, nine-hole hitter, will step up to the plate. He struck out his first plate appearance.
Yep.
Mustangs, once again, are going to play the infield. Going to hold the runner first, play the third baseman up near the grass, and play the middle infield back four in double play depth. As Smith gives the signs to Lamb. Runner first sits tight, and there's a high fly ball that's going to stay in fair territory. And the catch is made by Drawd over the runner at first base for the first out of the inning. Interesting play right there, as Drawd had to reach over the runner standing on first base to make the play.
Yeah, JC moved about 10 feet total, but it was an adventure nonetheless.
Now batting number 20, Harris McReynolds.
Well, we've talked about the big innings that the Mustangs have given up over the course of this six-game losing streak. And this is one that we need to try to find a way out of, because now the order has turned over again, and Harris McReynolds, who has home run and single today, will step up to the plate. The leadoff batter for the Volunteers as the runner goes, and a throw down towards Sanford, who was going to try to cut it off. Doesn't fool the runner at third base. Not a bad attempt right there by Smith and the Mustangs.
Yep. Yep.
Didn't let the ball go through. But now runners will be on second and third, and a base hit will plate two. Could extend this lead to five. So big batter here. Need to try to find a way to get this guy out to give ourselves a two-out situation.
Yep. This is Perry's first time catching Drew, so they understand how big of a spot is. So Perry goes out and talks to Drew, make sure they're on the same page for their strategy for this hitter.
Not a bad job by Smith so far behind home plate. Done what the coaches have asked of him. Is commanded with Drew on the mound. Here's the second pitch of the at-bat, is a strike on the outside edge for strike one. So 1-1 is the count, I believe. I believe the first pitch was a ball. We
correct.
Threw down to Dane Sanford on the cutoff.
Diamond Girls and I are in agreement on that.
Here's the 1-1 pitch from Lamb. Another ball on the outside edge misses. Smith had to really try to frame that ball, so now 2-1 count. As you see, Lamb trying to, I would say, pitch around McReynolds at this point, but you sure don't want to give him anything inside as he has turned on two of those pitches. Really sent him. And there's an inside pitch right there on the inside edge, called strike two. Don't know if he missed his location or not. Perry was kind of set up middle-middle, which I was expecting a curveball, but we didn't get it. Now Smith stands up. He's going to give the signal to Lamb as he gets the sign from Coach Thigpen. As Lamb pitches from the windup, and now time is called from by McReynolds.
Yeah, Drew very methodical with this at bat. You're saying it usually works kind of quickly, but really, really looking in on this hitter.
So here's the 2-2 pitch to McReynolds. Fastball, ground ball towards second baseman Flowers. He gloves it, he throws it over to first, and that's going to be the second out of the inning. And McReynolds is going to pick up an RBI. But not a bad job right there by the Mustangs. Good play by Flowers. Kind of got up on him, hopped on him, and it kind of got into his hands a little bit.
Randall Petro.
That's a hitter that, as you mentioned, had a homeward and a very sharp single. So, yeah, the out does score a run, but very good job of minimizing what could have been a big hit.
Single and a fly out to the second baseman for Futrell on the afternoon. Anything put on the ground could be a base hit for Futrell, as he has really good speed out of the right-hand batter box. This two-hole hitter, center fielder left fielder for the Volunteers. Second pitch misses down and away for ball two, so now 2-0 is the count to Futrell.
Trying to work them low.
Here's the 1-0 pitch from Lamb. 2-0 pitch. Line drive to center field. Nelson Hodges is going to come in on. He's going to make the play. And that is the end of the inning. So the Mustangs avoid the big inning.
They do.
After a disastrous start defensively for the Mustangs. But the Starkville Volunteers do pick up two more runs. There were two runs scored on two hits. There were two errors by the Mustangs. One error by the Mustangs. I apologize. And two men left on base. We will head to the bottom of the fourth inning, 6-2, Starkville Academy. .891 due up for the Mustangs here in the bottom of the fourth inning. As Elliot Flowers, who singled his first plate appearance, will step up to the plate. He also scored a run. Freshman McLean and Flowers have scored the two runs tonight for the Mustangs.
Now batting number 22, Elliot Flowers.
These freshmen have been in this lineup for quite some time now, most of the season, and certainly they earned that spot, and it's through their play. They're getting on, timely hits, good aggressive base running.
Swing and a miss on a fastball inside edge for strike one. Good cut right there by Flowers as Williamson works into his fourth inning of action. Only 37 pitches thrown so far. He throws a lot of strikes. Another swing and a miss by Flowers. As Williams works really fast here on the mound in the fourth. So the 0-2 pitch. Swing and a miss outside. Three pitches, three strikes, and Flowers goes down swinging. And that'll bring up Britt Reichle, the left fielder who drew a walk his first plate appearance. Britt Reichle trying to set the record for most hit by pitches in a single season in MAIS history. And we don't have our stats pulled up right now, but I can give you where he stands going into this at bat.
Did we ever figure out exactly what that record is?
No, but we gave you a job to do, Mr. B, and one of the jobs was to get the emblem on the live stream.
I think I'll move the camera if you want.
The other job, we're trying to finish our conversation from earlier for those who are listening. The other job was to find out who holds that record. Second pitch is on the outside edge, called strike two, so now 0-2 count to Reichle. As we've seen, five pitches and five strikes. Reichle has been hit four times this season. We need one right here. And here's the pitch. Called strike three, so now six pitches, six strikes, two outs for Williams as he is really starting to heat up here in the top of the bottom of the fourth inning. For those of you who don't know what we're talking about, the logo behind home plate is now the nice oval PA. For those of you who can't see it at home, gold PA with a green trim, green background with white trim. First pitch to Nelson Hodges is a fastball strike. Nelson grounded out to the shortstop, his first play appearance. Hit a hard ground ball just past the third baseman, his second at bat that plated both the runs. And there's a ground ball that's going to get through the infield for a base hit. And that'll be Hodges picking up the one-out, two-out single.
Number 12, Drew.
Broke up an immaculate inning, too.
He sure did break up an immaculate inning. We appreciate that from Hodges. As Lamb will step up to the plate, the 300-hitting pitcher can really help himself out here as we talk about home runs and eight home runs on the season for the Mustangs through 16 games. We're due one now, and one would be nice here. First pitch on the outside edge, call strike one. Lamb doesn't love it, but he's been getting that pitch too, so he'll have to take it. Williams really working strikes here in the fourth. Runner goes, Hodges goes, ball in the dirt, no throw. Hodges is going to slide in anyway. And so Lamb now has a runner in scoring position on the stolen base from Hodges. And I was going to go back to this as we're about to see a pitch, and so I didn't say, I'm not sure Williams stepped off when he turned and paused in between that last batter. I think he took his lead foot and stepped behind himself. Maybe it was a balk. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I saw that wrong from my vantage point. Here's the 1-1 pitch from Williams.
This
and
crew
ball inside for ball two.
This crew did call a balk in the JV game.
Well, I'll give him credit that I saw it wrong. And I'll give Williams credit that he did it right. He's been very sharp tonight and has a lot of poise on the mound.
And results the same, but it adds a stolen base to Nelson Hodges' call him there.
Absolutely. Williams, the most impressive part about his game tonight so far through three and two-thirds has been the number of strikes that he's thrown.
Very efficient.
Very efficient, very effective. He throws strikes, have good velocity. He does a good job with his off-speed pitches. Don't know where he stacks up in the rotation for the Volunteers, but we know they have a number of good arms simply because of their record. Here's the 2-1 pitch from Lamb, and there is another pause from Williams. Starkville Academy. Set for the 2-1 pitch, and it's down in the zone again for ball three. So Lamb, who leads the team in walks with 15, could find his way on with Gerard on deck.
We saw this before from this pitcher, how he's all over the zone and then he'll lose it for a bit. There was Britt trying to give himself up on a sack bunt. He got walked on four pitches, trying to give an out, and pitcher just couldn't find the zone.
Can't pull up the game changer right now to see the number of strikes thrown versus balls for Williams, but he has a pretty good ball to strike ratio right now. Here's a 3-1 pitch, and it misses him. Drew Lamb draws a walk.
Yeah, those balls, when they come, it's in bunches like that, it looks like. He's all over the zone, and then he'll just lose it for
now
a bit.
Now batting number 14, J.C. Girard.
So we got to take advantage now that J.C.'s up with two runners on, because he's lost the zone now, and he's got to – he's either going to lay off pitches for balls, or he knows that he's got to come right back across the plate to find it again. He's got to be ready for when he does.
So Lamb's going to jog back over to the dugout, and – Colin Moore is going to step on first base. J.C. Girard will be the batter for the Mustangs, and as he was in the second inning, not a better person that we want on up to the plate in the batter's box, and Girard with the runner in scoring position and two outs. Here's Girard. First pitch is a fastball that misses down for ball one. Girard is 1-for-2 on the afternoon. He flew out to left field in the second. He singled in the first. Was the first hit of the evening for the Mustangs. As Williams shakes off Davis, the catcher for Volunteers. Here's the 1-0 pitch. It's outside for ball two. So there's your – oh! Called strike one. So a 1-1 count. Not a bad pitch. Was tailing away from J.C. Left-handed batter. They are going to try to pitch J.C. away. We've seen that in conference play in these teams that are getting scouting reports on the Mustangs. Going to try to get him to go opposite field. He did go opposite field his last at-bat, but the ball kind of sailed on, got under it a little bit for the flyout. Williams taking a long time looking in on the signs. He checks the runner at second base. Comes setting here to the delivery, and it way outside, and it goes to the backstop. Nelson Hodges is going to take second, and Colin Moore, or third, Colin Moore takes second. As that ball got away from Williams.
I tell you what, that was strange. It was thrown so hard that it hit the missed the padding, hit the brick, so it bounced right back to the catcher, but it was thrown so hard that it went back past the catcher into fair territory, so still couldn't make a play to it.
The padding is one of the best new additions to Utroska Park this year, as we have brand-new padding behind home plate. Spelling out pillow. It's green padding with a gold pillow trimmed in white, and it looks really nice back there.
I'll try to get that on camera, too.
Breaking ball misses high for ball three, and now J.C. with a hitter's count with two outs and runners in scoring position. The Mustangs trail 6-2 here in the bottom of the fourth inning. Need to pick up a couple more runs to put a little pressure here on the Volunteers. As Williams looks in hard again. Here comes the windup in the pitch. Fastball up in the end, and it misses high. And now the tying run, Dane Sanford will step up to the plate with the bases loaded and two outs in the fourth inning.
I think Dane's about due for his weekly home run.
I don't know what I need to do. Time to do it. Here's the first pitch to Sanford. Fastball fouled away. He had the pitch he needed, and that ball's going to go out of play over towards the gym. He got the pitch. He just kind of pulled off on it a little bit. When we saw the swing coming, got a little bit on the edge of our seat. So here's the 0-1 pitch to Sanford. Line drive that is going to be gloved by the shortstop, thrown over to second base, and a great play by the Volunteers to get out of the inning. It got into the dirt, sailed low into the dirt right before the cutout into left center field. Shortstop did a great job arranging over and got the runner at second base for the out. So the Mustangs strand three, no runs on one hit, no errors by the Volunteers. Three men left on base. We'll head to the top of the fifth, 6-2. Starkville Academy leads.
Thank you.
Lamb steps back on the mound for work here in the top of the fifth inning with 3-4-5 coming up for the Volunteers. Aiden Alsobrooks will lead off. He has singled twice in this game. Got thrown out at second base in the first inning trying to advance off the single. Breaking ball on the outside corner. Call strike one. Good pitch by Lamb. Starkville Academy Volunteers are 3-0 in district. They played Bio Academy last week. Their record overall is 16-3. I tried to give them a few more wins than they have, saying they were close to 20, but they are close to 20. 16-3, good fastball on the inside edge for strike two. So now 0-2 count to Aiden Alsobrooks as Lamb pitches into the mid-60s. Done a great job of keeping us in this game.
Yeah, you're reading off how good Starkville's been this year. Just all the more credit to Drew for keeping this competitive.
Line drive, ride it. Brock makes it in, and he catches that one. Hit on the screws on the 0-2 pitch. It was a breaking ball that Lamb came back with. Makemson did a great job of staying with it and making the play. It was a hard hit ball. And Makemson getting a little more comfortable over there at third base.
Mm-hmm.
Starkville is 3-0 in district. They played Bio Academy in a three-game set. They won 8-0 and 12-7 in the doubleheader and won 18-1 on Tuesday night last week against Bio Academy at Bio Academy. Mustangs 0-3, lost, dropped three games to Heritage last week. Ball, breaking ball to Colby Allen, misses four ball one. Here's the 1-0 pitch to Allen. Ball up in the zone for ball two.
Same pitch.
So here's the 2-0 pitch to Allen, the second baseman for the Volunteers. It's ground ball. Elliott Flowers is going to glove it. He's going to come up and throw, and he's going to make the play. Good job by Flowers.
I tell you what, yeah, that was very hard hit ball that took some misdirection off of the pitcher's mound there. Flowers, great job of just knocking it down in the first place, but to recover and knew how much time he had. Set made a great throw to first. Just a tremendous play by Elliott there.
Absolutely. And, you know, just having poise to stick with that. And
absolutely.
Help his pitcher out, Lamb, getting the first two outs, and that'll bring up Cooper McNeil, the center fielder. He struck out and grounded out to the second baseman in a first pitch strike. Looked down at the zone, but can't really tell from here as Perry Smith kind of came down on a little bit. Having a hard time reading my score sheet as the Diamond Girls have decided that we're going to go dark in here tonight. Ground ball to Flowers again. He throws over to first, and J.C. Gerard makes the play. And three up, three down. Nice fifth inning of work by Lamb and the defense for the Mustangs. Good job by Flowers. Volunteers go three up, three down. No runs, no hits, no errors. Nobody left on base. We'll head to the bottom of the fifth. 6-2, Starkville Academy. So we're heading to the bottom of the fifth inning. Starkville Academy leads Pillow Academy 6-2. There have been 6 runs on 7 hits for Starkville Academy and 2 runs on 6 hits for the Mustangs. The Mustangs have made 2 errors. Starkville Academy 1. And the story of the game right now, Mr. B, would be runners left on base by the Mustangs. Through 4 complete innings, the Mustangs have left 7 runners on base, which means we've had opportunities in this game. Just haven't been able to capitalize when given those opportunities.
Yep, that's a stat I was actually mentally keeping note of, because once the bats have, and they have come alive lately, just getting that one more hit each inning could be make a world of difference.
Well, we'll have 5, 6, 7 up as Makemson McLean and Schmitz will be the batters that Williams will face here in the fifth inning. And Makepson hits a long fly ball into center field. That ball is going to be
gone
over the head of the center fielder. He's going to come up and fire to second, and Brock Makepson is going to have a stand-up double that went off the wall just shy or just left of the 355 sign. And Mr. B tried to give him a home run,
the thing.
Mr. B.
So as it hit the wall as the fielder lifted his glove, so I couldn't see the ball. I thought it was because it had left the yard. It did not. I apologize. Sarah Francis, very disappointed that you couldn't play the home run siren on that. I think we all are. We missed out on that.
That'll bring up Chamberlain McLean. McLean is 1-for-2 on the afternoon. He has singled and flew out to the third baseman, his last plate appearance. McLean comes up with a runner in scoring position. Don't know if Coach Thigpen's going to try to bunt Makepson over. Don't know if we're going to be able to give up outs here with only 9 left in the game. There's the first pitch on the outside edge. Misses 4-1. So Williams now finds himself in a little bit of trouble here in the fifth. Here's the pitch to McLean, and it's fouled away for strike one. So now 1-1 is the count. So the Mustangs can't afford to continue to strand runners in scoring position. They had a runner on second base with no outs here in the bottom half of the fifth inning. 1-1 pitch, and McLean swings and misses. Ball gets away from the catcher, and now Makepson will be 90 feet away and can help the Mustangs tighten this game up a little bit. The Volunteers scored 2 in the first, 2 in the fourth, or 2 in the third and 2 in the fourth for their 6 runs. The Mustangs got 2 in the second to answer the Volunteers, but have not scored since. They've left 5 runners stranded in the last 2 innings. They left the bases full in the fourth.
Big opportunity here. No outs, runner on third. Got to get one out of this inning.
So here's the 1-2 pitch to McLean, and it is a fastball right there on the outs, inside edge, called strike 3. Good pitch right there by Williams. And McLean goes down looking, and Trey Smits will be up to the plate. So Smits will step into the batter's box. He'll
step out of the batter's box almost immediately.
He popped out to the catcher his first plate appearance, trying to get a sacrifice bunt down, and then he flew out to the first baseman his last plate appearance. Here's the pitch, way outside for ball 1. Got to get something on the ground somewhere to try to get Makepson home, preferably in the middle of the infield somewhere, as the corners are playing on the grass here with 1 out in the fifth. And a swing and a miss on a half swing right there by Schmitz. Kind of gave it that one and pitched it, was just a little bit out of the zone.
Yeah, I think he kind of realized in the middle of his swing there that it's one he probably shouldn't have offered on.
If you've never done that on YouTube, if you're a baseball fan, go and look at bad swings, Major League Baseball players on YouTube, and there's some funny swings. Even Major League Baseball players do it from time to time.
Oh, yeah.
1-1 now is the count to Schmitz. Brock Makepson stands on third. Mustangs trail by 4 here in the fifth. Ball down in the zone, misses. Good job of blocking up right there by Davis to protect the lead with the runner on third. And now 2-1 is the count to Schmitz. On deck is Elliott Flowers, the defensive star from the last inning, as he made 2 plays back-to-back. Help the Mustangs out defensively. Here's the 2-1 pitch. Down and away for ball 3, so now 3-1 is the count. So Williams' pitch count is now mid-60s to 70s. Mid-60s to low 70s, as the board is showing 64. Board not always accurate because foul ball 2-2 counts don't get put on there. 2 strike foul balls don't get put on there. Here is the 3-1 pitch now to Schmitz. Works out of the windup. And a hard hit line drive that'll get by the second baseman. And that'll be Schmitz's first hit of the game.
Yep.
And that will tighten that lead up for the Volunteers as the Mustangs are able to capitalize on the leadoff double by Makepson as Snips drives in an RBI.
Good solid contact opposite field, finding that hole in the infield there. Very, very nice piece of hitting to bring the run home.
And now the score is 6-3. Starkville Academy leads here in the bottom of the fifth inning. So Elliott Flowers steps up to the plate. He's 0 for 2, 1 for 2. He singled his first plate appearance, and he walked. I'm sorry, struck out in the fourth. He squares the bunt, and he pulls back on the strike. Breaking ball in there for a strike. Outside middle on location. Flowers trying to do anything he can to get on base. Britt Reichle stands in the on-deck circle. Line drive into center field. Center fielder is going to settle under it, make the play, and that'll be the second out of the inning. Good contact by Flowers, but he couldn't find a way to get it down.
Yeah, Mustangs putting together some good swings here in the past few innings.
Have made good contact against Williams. He hasn't been a strikeout pitcher. As a matter of fact, the only two strikeouts of the afternoon so far, or there's three strikeouts in the game. Two in the third, or two in the fourth, and one now in the fifth. That'll bring up Britt Reichle with a runner on first base and two outs, trailing 6-3 here in the bottom of the fifth. There's the pitch to Reichle. Oh. And a swing and a foul ball that's going to go off the hand of Reichle. Would have been his fifth hit by a pitch if he could have held up on that a little bit. He swung through it. Ball goes off the knuckles. That can't feel good.
No, and not even the reward of first base after that. That was about worst-case scenario.
Worst-case scenario for Reichle. Absolutely. So here is the 0-1 pitch to Reichle. Fastball outside edge misses. Four ball one, so now 1-1 is the count. Mr. B looking at the hourly forecast. Looks like they pushed that rain chance up a little bit to about 1 o'clock tomorrow.
Okay.
1 to 3. 3 to 4 is going to be your hour that those storms are going to push through here.
Nice of it to rain on a non-baseball day for a change.
Swing and a miss on the fastball inside for strike two. So now 1-2 to Britt Reichle. Reichle trying to extend this inning here. 6-3 is the score. Williams checks his runner at first, comes set. Here's the 1-2 pitch. Pass ball up, misses, four ball two, so now 2-1 count. Lineup is going to turn over for the fourth time for the Mustangs here. After this at bat, Nelson Hodges is standing there. Hodges has two RBIs on the afternoon. The only two RBIs, well, I'm sorry, two of the three RBIs for the Mustangs.
With so, Trey Smith knocking in Brock Makepson in this inning as Trey stands on first.
Reichle calls timeout, steps out, and he gets ready to face the 2-2 pitch. So here's the 2-2 pitch to Reichle. Swing and a miss and a strike three, and that's the fourth strikeout of the night for Williams. And the Mustangs will go down. But they do get one back, Mr. B.
That's right.
Not a bad inning for the Mustangs. We had one run on two hits. No errors by the Volunteers. One man left on base. We're going to head to the top of the sixth inning. Starkville Academy leading 6-3. Need a good inning right here from the Mustangs to get us back in that batter's box. We'll be back momentarily. Bottom of the sixth inning. We're in the top of the sixth inning. Evan Seary will be the leadoff batter of the third baseman for the Volunteers. Is 6-7-8 will come up to face Lamb here as he has really thrown a good game so far.
Sure has. Really eating up the innings very effectively here. It's important in these three-game sets.
So here comes the first pitch to Seary. Breaking ball that's up in the zone. Misses 4-1. Seary flew out to, or lined out to Dane Sanford his first at bat. Then he reached on an error to start the fourth inning, and the fourth inning that kind of had an opportunity to get away. There's a line drive hit in the gap, and that ball's going to get down. That ball's going to one-hop the wall. It's going to be fielded by Reichle and thrown into the infield, and J.C. Gerard does a good job of trailing to second base, but a hard hit by Seary. His first hit of the night will be a leadoff double, so back-to-back innings.
Now batting number 15, Will McReynolds.
Or back-to-back at bat, Seary has found himself on base. As he goes to get his mitt from the coach. Will McReynolds will come up to the plate. He has struck out and singled in this game. His single last at bat was a bunt single trying to move the runner over. If I were the Mustangs, I'd be anticipating another bunt from McReynolds here.
Yeah, it was a beauty.
And have a good bunt defense call. And he squares around, and the curveball thrown. Good pitch right there by Lamb. On the first pitch, anytime you're going to see somebody bunt, it's not a bad idea to throw an off-speed pitch. Ball missed out of the zone. So Makemson staying put. Looks like Gerard is going to charge. Here squares around the bunt. Lamb's going to have to cover the third base side. Makemson's going to try to make the play, and he does. Fantastic play right there by Makemson, who's feeling it the last couple innings over there at third base. He made two fantastic plays here recently.
Yeah, that was bunted foul, and Brock charged it hard in foul territory and grabbed it right out of the air.
Now batting number two.
The fly out or the pop out right there is a huge out for the Mustangs. And that'll bring up Hayes Davis, the catcher. He reached on the air the first plate appearance. He singled his last plate appearance. He's been on base both times that he's batted in this game.
Starkville does have someone warming in the pen.
High fly ball, right field side in that triangle. Everybody hustling. Flowers out to catch it. He does make the play. The runner's going to try to advance to third, and Flowers throws it to third. Great job by Makerson getting up and making the snag on that, as that was going to go to the fence. And the runner tags from third, but the Mustangs now have two outs in the inning and with the opportunity to strand a leadoff double are the Mustangs.
That's the second time now we've seen Flowers kind of take charge on a pop fly. Just a freshman out there, but not afraid to really assert his position and be vocal out there, call people off to get that. And a great play by Brock to snag that throw.
Drew Williams will step up to the plate, the pitcher trying to help himself out here. He has struck out and flew out to the first baseman. Curveball misses inside. Once again, a big position here for Lamb as he's trying to work his way out of a runner on third base and needs help from his defense to do so. Top of the sixth inning, 6-3 is the lead for the Volunteers. Here's the windup. The pitch is a ground ball towards Flowers. He gloves it, hard ground ball, throws it to Gerard, and Elliott Flowers is on fire as he makes the play. And he has played phenomenal defense here
just
in this game tonight. What a showing by the freshman.
Absolutely.
Flowers defensively. No doubt about it. So no runs on one hit. No errors by the Mustangs. We'll head into the bottom of the sixth. Top of the order coming up. 6-3 is the lead for the Volunteers.
So after Mustangs did a great job in the field, working around a leadoff double and stranding them without letting another runner cross the plate, the Mustangs are in striking distance here in the bottom of the sixth, down 6-3, with the top of the order coming up for the fourth time as Nelson Hodges will step in after a quick cleaning of the plate.
Now batting number 10, Nelson Hodges.
We don't have the new pitcher for the Volunteers' name. Number 12 will step on. Tall, hard-throwing, left-handed pitcher for the Volunteers. Looks like that kind of guy that comes in to close out innings and close out games. Got a lot of movement on that fastball. We'll see what it looks like here. Ball outside, misses for ball one to Hodges. If the Mustangs want to take advantage of a situation, they need to do so now as the top of the order is up to the plate. 1-0 pitch to Hodges, fastball. It misses low for ball two, so now 2-0 the count to Hodges. Hodges is 1-for-3 on the night. He's reached on an error, singled, and drove in two runs. High fly ball that's going to stay on the infield. Kind of got under that 2-0 pitch. Third baseman is going to glove it, and that'll be the first out of the inning.
Yeah, it's a little underneath that.
Had a good pitch to hit. He threw him a fastball, and he just didn't quite make great contact with it.
It's a home run in a silo.
Home run and foul like that.
Number 12, Drew Lamb.
So Drew Lamb, the starting pitcher who's been phenomenal tonight, will step into the batter's box. Lamb is 0-for-1 on the night. He grounded out to the second baseman. He has a sack bunt and a walk as he sees a first pitch strike one.
He almost beat out that sack bunt, too. That was a great, well-timed, well-executed bunt there.
Little chopper back to the pitcher. He's going to pick it up. He's going to run it over to first base, toss it underhanded, and that's going to be the second out of the inning. And that'll bring up J.C. Gerard.
Now batting number 14,
J.C.
Gerard.
J.C. Gerard will step up to the plate. He has walked, flew out to left field, and singled in his three at-bats. See if the Mustangs can't get something done here with two outs. First pitch is inside, just misses Gerard as it almost got him. Mustangs are going to have to get some base runners here as they trail by three here in the sixth. 6-3 is your score. Three runs on eight hits for the Mustangs, six runs on eight hits for the Volunteers. 1-0 pitch is outside for ball two. So here's the 2-0 pitch. Swing and a foul ball off the catcher shin guard. And it goes out, bounces off the backstop, and goes back on the field of play.
Well, the Diamond Girls are talking about how antsy they are to hit the home run siren. So if JC comes through here, I think we're going to have to oblige them.
If they listen to you on the call on live stream, they would have hit it for Brock Makepson when he hit one off the wall here earlier tonight. Mr. Banu doesn't have a lot to say.
I don't. I messed that one up.
I wouldn't say messed up is a good way to put it. It is hard to see that ball when it gets down around that wood. There's another pitch inside on Gerard, so now 3-1 is going to be the count. Gerard has worked ahead in every at-bat tonight.
Well, what leads to hitting 500 with a 8-something, 6-something OPS.
Absolutely.
Or OBP.
And a fly ball on a breaking ball that's going to trail towards left field. Left fielder's going to try to settle it. He does get underneath it and makes the play. So the ball had a lot of tail on it. It was working back.
Yeah, and he was. I thought he was going to misplay that. I could see it tailing while the to our left while the fielder was running to our right still, but he did make the late adjustment, unfortunately.
We'll see if the Mustangs are going to send Drew Lamb back out to the mound, and they are, to try to finish this inning off as he's going to face the top of the order for the fourth time tonight. We'll see how long he stays out there as he's worked his pitch count up to around 80-81. We're heading to the top of the seventh inning. 6-3 is the score. Starkville Academy leads. We'll be back momentarily. So Harris McReynolds will lead off the top of the seventh inning with the Volunteers leading 6-3 here against the Mustangs. McReynolds, the shortstop, has a home run, a single, and he grounded out to Elliott Flowers in the fourth inning. As the Mustangs have worked, Drew Lamb has worked only through seven batters in the last two innings. Lamb has gotten better as the game goes on as he sees a fastball, high velocity down the middle, swing and a miss right there by McReynolds.
Just another outstanding outing from Drew.
We'll see how long he goes in this inning here as he's facing the top of the order for the fourth time. Breaking ball misses way outside for ball one, so now 1-1 is the count. Would have to imagine that John Heston Powers would be the next man up as he is not in the lineup tonight. He'd be easy guy to get loose, but he's not getting loose right now, but don't know if he has been.
I haven't been checking. That window's also foggy.
Here's a fastball down his own foul away.
Off the light post and lands right in front of Drew.
Almost hit Drew. That would have been one of the strangest injuries that you would have ever seen. And now a 1-2 pitch coming up to McReynolds. First inning, third pitch of the game, McReynolds took a ball over dead center field right next to the flagpole. That led off the scoring in the first. They got two in the first, two in the third, and two in the fourth. Since that time, Drew Lamb and the Mustangs have held the Volunteers scoreless with some good defensive plays. Noticeably, great defensive plays by third baseman Brock Makerson and second baseman Elliott Flowers, who has been phenomenal tonight. Here's the 1-2 pitch. Breaking ball that hits down in the dirt. Very fortunate that it did not catch McReynolds. So here is the 2-2 pitch. Line drive into left field. Reichle's going to come in on it, and the ball's going to get down right in front of him for a base hit single. And that is the way that the Volunteers will start the inning with a runner on base and now Randall Futrell coming up to the plate. Futrell, a single, flew out to the second baseman, and he flew out to center field his last plate appearance in the fourth inning. 1-for-3 on the night. Futrell with a lot of speed. You got to think that Lamb now pitching out of the stretch is going to probably, I would imagine, that the Volunteers are willing to put a little pressure on the Mustangs on the base pass here. Lamb checks over to first, throw and a tag by George Nighttime.
No, he doesn't have a mitt. You sure he's going?
As a leadoff batter, you would think that he'd be a threat to steal, but he does not have the mitt. He is still wearing his batting glove, though, or either he has a wrist taped up, one of the two. Good athlete is McReynolds, for sure. As Futrell squares around the bun and a call strike, Futrell didn't like that call. Futrell didn't give for the pullback, still got the strike call. Futrell with the speed at the bait on the base pass. You're going to have to do a great job to get him out if he puts a good bunt down. J.C. Gerard does a tremendous job there to save that ball from going to the right field fence.
Look at that good pick there.
So here's the 0-1 pitch. Runner moves. Smith comes up. He throws. Good throw down to second, and the tag is not quite in time.
Yeah. Pretty good throw there by Perry, right on the money. One hop. It's just kind of tough to corral there.
Smith has much better pop time than we probably gave him credit for. If we've seen him throw out a runner second base, he's done a good job throwing down a third. He really gets the ball out of his hand quickly.
Very, very, very quick, quick pop time, yeah.
Here's the 1-1 pitch.
Good coordination.
And Futrell squares. The ball goes over the head of Futrell, and he goes to the backstop, and Smith will have to go corral it. And now there's a runner on third with no outs in the seventh inning, and Futrell way ahead in the count, 2-1.
Mustangs down three. You know, every little run that they can add to this just makes the hill that much tougher to climb. But it, as it stands now, is climbable.
Mustangs playing it with the infield in here. Need a strike thrown into Futrell. There's the pitch. Ground ball towards third baseman Makepson. He looks back the runner. Great throw to first base. Good defense by the Mustangs to hold that runner at third base.
Brock relatively fresh here at the third base position, but a great instincts, great internal clock there, knowing he had time to look the runner back and still set and make a good throw.
Well, what we saw from Brock early in the game were a couple of errors, and then since that time he has settled in. He fielded a hard hit line drive, did a great job on the bunt, the pop fly, then a great job looking back the runner there, making a great throw to J.C. Girard, first baseman, for the out. So now one out, and that brings up Aiden Alsobrooks. There's the first pitch inside for ball one. Alsobrooks on the afternoon, the right fielder, has two singles, and he hit the line drive. He hit the line drive right at Brock Makepson on an 0-2 pitch. It was a breaking ball outside that Makepson fielded cleanly. Hard hit fly ball, deep right field. That ball is back. Schmitz turns on it, and he makes the catch for the out. Because the ball stayed up, but that will plate the run. But Schmitz does a good job of making the play and getting the out and minimizing the damage there. Off the bat, it looked like it had a chance.
Yeah, off the bat, I thought that was hitting the Scott, but I really did. But it hung up there, and a good job, Trace, to get under that.
Trace did a good job of regrouping and making the out because he had to turn when he got back towards the fence, and he lost the ball, but he was able to regain sight of it and make the play. So good job by Trace. Looking to throw all seven innings is Lamb as he pitches with two outs here in the seventh inning. He is not faced. Well, we'll hold that stat until the end of the game at this point. 1-0 is the pitch here to Colby Allen, who is 0-for-3 on the night with a strikeout, a fly out, and a ground out. And there's another high-hit fly ball. That ball's going to be in the triangle between all three players on the left side, and it's going to sail out of play just beyond the tarp. We saw a great pitching performance by Lamb against Oak Forest. We saw another great pitch performance by Lamb against Heritage Academy, and now we're seeing the same thing from him here against Starkville. They've scored 7 runs on 9 hits. So you got to know this lineup to understand what he's done to keep him in check. He's got really good defense behind him.
At times, got
a couple of defensive breakdowns, like we said. Only 2 errors on the night so far for the Mustangs. We need to keep that number right there and get out of this inning with 2 outs here in the 7th. Trying to overthrow right here. Now, Allen's worked a 3-1 count.
So he's got 2 down. He's got the bases empty. Can't be, you know, don't want to be overthrowing here, you know. You got, just don't got to worry about another run coming in. Just get the batter here.
Here's the 3-1 pitch, and it's up in the zone, misses for the first walk of the afternoon by Drew Lamb. Comes with 2 outs in the top of the 7th inning. If you want to talk about effective pitching and what makes a pitcher really, really good, that's it. Walking batters, staying away from that in high school baseball is huge. And he is going to exit with 6 2/3 thrown. And it looks like that Coach Thigpen is going to turn to Brock Makepson to come in and try to get the last out of the 7th inning with a runner on and the Mustangs trailing 7-3. So Lamb's going to move over to third base. Makepson's going to warm up. When Makepson gets loose, we'll come back and we'll have the call for the rest of the game. So we're back here with one out in the bottom of the top of the seventh inning, and the Mustangs trailing 7-3. Drew Lamb exited. He pitched 6 2/3. He gave up 7 runs on 9 hits. Those runs were spaced out over time, and he never faced more than 6 batters in one. I'm sorry, he faced. That's right. He never faced more than 5 batters in an inning. 6 batters in an inning. I apologize for that. We'll talk about that stat in just a minute. But he only had 1 walk, and that 1 walk was the last batter. That last batter was Colby Allen, and that brings up Cooper McDaniel. If Brock Makinson comes in to try to get this final out, needs some a good, clean, quick inning right here, or a quick out by Makinson, as we anticipate that he'll start one of the games at Starkville on Thursday night.
True. Doing some quarterbacking there, telling Britt to scoot in a bit and left.
Ground ball that's going to get through just past Dane Sanford. Sanford hustled for it, couldn't quite get there. Reichle gets it back into the infield, and that's going to be a single for Cooper McNeil.
Now batting number 7, Evan Seary.
And number 7, Evan Seary will step up to the plate. He's 1-for-2 on the afternoon, 1-for-3. He flew out, reached on an error, and he hit a double his last plate appearance. His last plate appearance was a double, which was the hardest hit ball by the Volunteers aside from the home run to lead off the game for the Volunteers, and that was a ball that one hopped the wall in left field. First pitch was a fastball that missed up and in. So two runners on here with one out, or two outs in the top of the seventh. Another pitch goes up, it'll in, and Smith acted like he never saw it behind home plate. Both runners are moved in scoring position, and Smith's going to go out and talk to Makinson. It looks like they might have got crossed
up. I think so. I think that's why the mound visit there, because you're right, Perry did not expect that ball there at all.
So a two-out walk is the last runner that Lamb is in line for. He stands on third base. 2-0 pitch from Makinson is a ball in the dirt that misses for ball 3. So now 3-0 count to the third baseman. We'll see if coach gives him the green light with 2 outs in the seventh and the ball on the outside edge calls strike 1. Don't know if you'd have swung at that even if you had the green light.
I agree. That was off the outside part of the plate, a ball that's been called a strike all night. So, but still, really tough for a right-hander to do anything with that.
3-1 pitch is popped up on the infield. Makinson looks like he wants to make the play. He comes in, and he does, and he gets out of the inning with no damn more damage done. So good job of Makinson to come in and get the out that was needed to not allow any more runs to score, but they do pick up one. The Mustangs are going to head into the bottom of the seventh inning. They trail by 4, 7-3. So new pitcher on the mound for Starkville Academy to try to close this game out. A 7-4 game here in the bottom of the seventh inning. 7 runs on 10 hits for the Volunteers. 3 runs on 8 hits. 2 errors by the Mustangs. 8 men stranded for the Mustangs tonight is the difference in this ball game, and opportunities to score with runners in score position. 7 of the 8 were in scoring position when they were stranded, and I think that is the stat of the game.
Absolutely.
Dane Sanford will lead off the inning. The shortstop has singled, grounded out twice. Ball misses way outside for ball one. Here's the 1-0 pitch. Swing and a miss on a fastball outside for strike one.
Dane with a swing. He looked like he wanted that run they gave up back right then and there.
Don't need to chase the fence right now. We got to get base runners. We're going to have to go station to station here and string together some hits. 1-1 pitch is a breaking ball that misses way upstairs. That ball started really, really high.
Yeah.
Kind of broke down almost to the chest before it was over with, but man, he started that ball off high. 2-1 now is the count to Sanford. Brock Makepson stands on deck. Makepson did a great job coming in, getting that last out. Ground ball that is going to be fielded cleanly by the third baseman, and a great throw over to first base for the first out of the inning. And Sanford grounds out, and now the Mustangs down to their final two outs of the evening.
Brock hit a double that, if you're listening to me, was a homer earlier.
Lost it right there when it got in the wood on the fence when it was dropping.
A tremendous contact nonetheless.
Pitch that misses outside, and I will have to say for Starkville Academy fans and coaches right there, that's a ball that's been called a number of times tonight, but 34 doesn't get it, and that's a ball. We'll take it. Another pitch on the outside edge, almost same spot, called a strike this time. Good job by the catcher for the Volunteers framing up. Makepson on the evening has two hits. He singled, and he doubled his last plate appearance. He hit a double off the wall. Now he's got ahead in the count 2-1. Chamberlain McLean, the freshman, stands on deck. McLean, going to have to help us. Bring some hits together. Fastball fouled off.
Yeah, just missed that one. That was a good cut.
Now the count is even. Hit 2-2. Here's the 2-2 pitch to Makemson. Breaking ball goes over his head. So full count now. Makepson didn't really make a great attempt to get out of the way there, trying to find his way on base here with one out in the bottom of the seventh.
Yeah, it was a breaking ball. It's not thrown too fast. He's wearing a helmet. Good thought by Brock there.
And a swing and a miss on a fastball, and Makepson will go down there, and the Volunteers are one out away from closing this game out and taking the first game of this three-game set. Second week of conference
play. Now batting
play.
Number 24, Chamberlain McLean.
So McLean, down to the last out, will come up. He has a single. He flew out to the third baseman, and he struck out looking his last plate appearance. First pitch to McLean. Fastball outside edge. Called strike one. I will say that the umpires have done a good job tonight. They've kept the pace of play up.
Absolutely.
Swing and a foul ball off the catcher's mitt for strike two. So now the Mustangs down to their final strike here in the bottom of the seventh inning.
The other umpire doing the JV game, he actually commented on how consistent he was, and this umpire's the same. Both with pretty wide zones, but been really calling it for both teams. Really good job by the crew here tonight. Not you guys.
Here's the 0-2 pitch, and it's a swing and a miss and a strikeout by McLean as he chased the ball out of the zone right there. And that's the way the ball game will end. 7-3 is the final score. Starkville Academy picks up the win. Tremendous effort from a lot of Mustangs, though. We have a two-game set with Starkville starting at 4 o'clock on Thursday afternoon from Starkville, Mississippi. Please tune in and follow our Mustangs. We appreciate the Booster Club for what they do to provide our live stream. We appreciate all of our sponsors who are advertised on our live stream and all those who support Pillow Academy Athletics. Thank you for listening. Mr. Bernou, thank you.
And the Diamond Girls, I suppose.
Mr. Benu says thank you to the Diamond Girls. Good job by the Mustangs tonight. Just fell a little short, Mr. B.
Yep. A lot of positives to take away from that. But fortunately, another loss in the books.
Well, we will be back in action trying to pick up a win on Thursday. Thank you for all those who listen. It's a great day to be a Mustang, and we will see you Thursday night.